I'd like to convene this meeting of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District for April 6, 2023. Holly, can you take roll, please?
President Smalley.
Here.
Vice President Hill.
Here.
Director Ackman.
Here.
Director Falls.
Here.
Director Mayhood.
Here.
Any addition or deletions to the closed session?
Yes, Chair Smalley, the council is going to ask to remove item 4B.
Correct. Thank you, Rick.
Okay, so you can hear, you want to go ahead, Gina? I didn't know if you could hear.
Sure. Well, that's it. I'd like to pull item 4B for and reserve it for discussion at the next board meeting.
Okay. That was my only change to the
Oral communications. Do we have anybody from the public in attendance at this point? Holly?
Dave McNair is still in attendance.
Okay.
Dave, if you have anything to say about what's on.
Anything that's on the closed session agenda, of which there's one item at this point. If not, I'd like to then adjourn to the closed session. So, close out of this open meeting and now transition to the closed session with just Gina.
Director Ackman,
here.
Director Falk.
Can you hear us, Jim?
You.
Can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you.
Well, that's good. That's a start. Let's see if Corby can hear us.
So
questions should be directed at
official draft at the start of the Rick said there's specific number details and things. So comments on this? hear us?
I heard that.
I think we've got a temporary solution. I'm going to hit up Carly and see if she can hear us.
I can hear you.
Yes, everybody else can hear. Yes, it is.
We make the electricity go out. We can do this by candlelight. If I could support a motion to move the RFP forward, I would like to include a Bob's concern regarding how the compensation structured. I would like to propose that we run the RFP and that ad hoc committee round of proposals and do an initial review recommending a preferred subset of the proposals to the full board for discussion.
I'm just letting you know, I mean, so I don't know what you guys have been doing for the past 25 minutes, but there's been no audio. Now there is audio, but it's only intermittently audible. I mean, sometimes it's clear, but it's sometimes at low level and not really cutting in and out. So I'm just letting you know that.
Is that dependent upon who you can recognize speaking?
Well, so far I was able to hear Jamie. I couldn't hear Bob, and I can hear you.
Okay. So it sounds like the sound level of voice. I think so. Do we need to pass this Polycom around?
Maybe get a little bit closer.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you for that comment, Mark.
How about that, Mark? Is it better?
Yes, it is.
Other comments from the public? Mr. Moser?
I was just going to echo what Mark said. I haven't been able to follow anything up till now. I don't even know what the agenda item is that you're asking for comments. The sound did get a little better, but it's still very intermittent.
Okay, we're working on improving that. And the agenda item has been the RFP for solicit executive search firms for the general manager recruitment.
We know let's review a first track.
So
we'll go back for additional work. And
we have a motion on the table. We have a second for this. Holly, go back, but we're, what exactly are we doing again?
I believed that I was making a motion to move the RFP forward with the changes that you've identified so that it can be released.
Yes, thank you. Yes, thank you. That's what I thought too. I wasn't sure. Right. Okay.
I meant Jamie and I would go back to work on.
Okay.
President Smalley.
Yes.
Vice President Hill.
Yes.
Director Ackman. Yes. Director Fultz.
Yes.
Director Mayhood.
Yes.
Okay. We got through an agenda item. Right. Moving on then to new business. The emergency contract for temporary work on Stewart Street. Rick?
Yes, give me just. Okay, staff is asking that the board ratify the attached emergency services contract previously signed by the district manager for the December 2023 disaster. The district at grade main connecting the below grade main and Stewart up in the Riverside Grove area was damaged by slope failure. So that was active again during the storm period in order to facilitate water. We needed temporary mainline installation. The district issued into an emergency contract with Anderson Pacific Engineering and deployed a crew immediately to accomplish this construction contract. To approve. So this work has been done. The temporary man has been done.
Understood. Trust to ratify the contract. Comments from this on the public? Seeing none. Then I move that the board ratify the provided emergency services contract for the construction of temporary main at Stewart Street in the amount of
amendment to Anderson.
Thank you. Holly.
President Smalley.
Yes.
Vice President Hill.
Yes.
Director Ackman. Yes. Director Fultz.
Yes.
Director Mayhood.
Yes.
The next item is the rate study request for proposals.
The district completed a rate study back in 2017 that resulted in a five-year rate increase of revenues and expenses on an annual basis. Studies are usually done every 2 years. The rate was budgeted in the annual budget. Request for proposal for the June was published on February 9th. We solicited bids from seven consulting firms that work California, but in California, and received bids in BS and Capitellus. Staff reviewed the proposals and scored weighted scoring as noted in RFP. Both firms showed an overall understanding of the district's needs for the rate study, while IMB last work with the district in the past and conducted the last rate study in 2017. Tell us a proposal to address specific issues and concerns that the district is currently facing. This item was taken to the Budget and Finance Committee to review. I'll ask the Budget and Finance Committee.
The Budget and Finance Committee devoted an entire meeting to thorough discussion, and in the end, the committee agreed with the staff recommendation to Raftellis. Overall, the committee was impressed with Raftellis' up-to-date legal expertise in setting water rates and their and local experience. The latter experience includes the 2021 rate study for they're up to date with the local challenges facing. One of the main reasons for choosing Raftellis is that we thought the district would benefit from a fresh look at its rate structure. The other firm, NBS, conducted our 2017 proposal. It sort of seems very similar to what might have been written when trying to do that. And we know that the state of play regarding how this fund to buildings regarded and allocating costs across different types of ratepayer classes. In addition, some members of the committee read the presentation in 2017, not affected. In contrast, when we read the materials that presented 2021 rates undertook. They were designed to communicate effectively with the factors driving the proposal. Two other aspects of the proposal that were significant also account for the difference between the two. Number of on-site visits and providing Raftellis proposed four in-person meetings. In their descriptions of the visits, Raftellis demonstrated a recognition that solicitation from the community early in the process before decisions of in contrast, the only on-site meeting NBS up to 18 hearings itself and our team shows that it's so over with the public outreach makes it. Raftellis' proposal includes a choice of user-friendly Excel and web-based. During the rate study and after used to calculate financial scenarios based on changes variables such as different rates, water consumption, labor costs, and other expenses. Lack such a tool, which is meant a request by the board to staff for what-if scenarios require significant staff that were considered this a key item in our request. For these reasons, we voted 5-0 to recommend that the board direct the district contract with Raftellis pending a check on references and a response from legal counsel about first accept contract requested. I just heard from Kendra that she talked for on terms that we had praise from Raftellis and highlighted the understanding from a legal framework and policy issues regarding Prop 218. Something that Gina has independently learned from her own. Gina also concluded that given the particular nature nature of the professional by a rate the contract work. So with that, we direct the district manager contract with Graftellus in an amount of $29,035.
We have a motion. I'd like to second that and then continue discussion. Questions on
did they do a demonstration? Did they do a demonstration of their model?
I'll just repeat the question. No, they did not do a demonstration of to us. However, Kendra did go online and use their web-based model that was very user-friendly and with the only thing that was available from NBS cell program that was very cumbersome, much preferred.
Web-based as in proprietary or web-based as in I can still export to Excel or import from Excel?
I don't know the details about that, but it was clear in the RFP that
okay, so they weren't providing long-term access to the model, exporting it to Excel and then working in Excel afterwards.
Yeah.
I mean, the reason I'm asking that is if they're offering a SaaS model like in perpetuity, that's a significant input into my decision. If it's a one-shot deal, you're going back to Excel. It's like, well, I mean, that's not as attractive. So, because we still have to go back.
I believe going back to Excel is merely our ability to go and do other.
Well, but what does the contract say? So that's
we haven't seen that.
Okay, so I think you're right, Gail, in that the modeling is a thing. Because without that, my opinion, I think NBS was responsive. They've done it before. They're certainly a lot cheaper. And, you know, I'm all about money. But if there's a value here that's significant to us for the long term, then that $15,000 or roughly is worth it. Without knowing that, I can't.
Well, I think what I would say is, I can't answer the part, and I don't know if Kendra's listening and if she knows the answer to this. But what I can say is that the availability of the web-based, if it were only during the course of doing the rate study, very valuable because it means different areas allow us and easily that we can then communicate on ourselves.
And so that means that the community would have access to this web-based tool as well to be able to go on.
I don't think okay,
but I mean, this is the clarity that I think we need, at least that I need. I mean, you guys can certainly vote on it tonight, but in terms of me voting on it, that is the key. That is the entire linchpin. I did have one, and so I'm glad you addressed it, but I still have questions about it.
I just also say that the difference also includes an additional that's important outreach event early in the process.
I am less unless there's information to communicate. And at this point in time, a lot of what the factors are that might be inputs into that communication have not really been presented to the public. So I'm not convinced without a little more structure about what that outreach would be communicating that there's much value in it. And on the last rate increase, I mean, I felt really sorry for NBS. I was actually involved in it. It was an incoherent rate increase that was sticker shock to the max. No one could have communicated effectively around that because of the manner in which the board actually went about doing it. So I cut him a little bit of slack on that. The other key item, though, that I wanted to query a little bit more about, Raphael Abatelis, sorry, say that three times fast, showed more relevant experience in what the district is. What specific items they show that expertise?
I think that what I said was that in their response, they were more responsive to the thing.
Sorry, I'm just reading off the summary sheet here, which says Raffatella showed more relevant experience to what the district. I was wondering what those.
I think that was Kendra's.
You would say it differently.
Well, okay. Things that we're talking about is they brought up more specificity. Third rates, how you deal a lot and variety of ways to think what we saw with MBS was basically us that it was created now and they just what I wanted to see was an exploration. I felt really strongly that we had a fresh look that was an exploration. All these other ways of how we want to structure.
And paraphrase, NBS remains in the box. Raffatellis was thinking out of the box.
Right.
Were they looking at this from an unbundling point of view relative to the rates in terms of charging, rather than charging just one lump sum for fixed and assumption that they were going to unbundle the rates in some way relative to capital infrastructure, treatment and delivery, et cetera, that the community might get a better feel for where the money's going for each area.
I don't think it was in a thing exactly. But is that the structure of the Santa Cruz? Very much are
bundling. I mean, I think that is one of the trends that we ought to take a look at.
Yeah, and that was, you know, I have to say that at least that was one of the things. Quality of their presentation. Our people at Santa Cruz were effective at communicating. With regard to where that would just have to stay there and that where the revenue could only or basically up surcharge that could only be used in a so they definitely had and so I'm presuming that to do that they obviously had to given the California.
Yeah, and I think that's really important relative to our district, and that at least the last couple of years, virtually 100% of the rate increase has been operating expenses. But yet, by increases in operating expenses. So you don't really get that feel of, well, what's going to capital versus what's going to operating. And those are very different buckets that also the community needs given more information about so that they understand what the rates are all about, right?
particularly given where we are with our capital infrastructure. None of what they need to be. Okay, I because of my experience dealing with SaaS vendors, I'm one right now, I really need to have more information on that. I mean, if you guys are comfortable with going forward, great, I can. But night because of that, that is to me the linchpin of the entire.
I'm not clear from their proposal what format or whether it's software as or proprietary or not. It's not. It's a model.
Well, can I just say that Sandra investigated this? I think that the concerns that Bob have really I would expect are.
No, I don't necessarily think so. I think that, again, it depends on whether or not this is used as a loss leader or an entry level into the sale, or whether this is really something that's part of the offering. It's a very different thing. And I've seen SaaS vendors do both kinds of things.
Boilerplate. Both of these done the same. Boilerplate, not in specific offer model options, including Microsoft Excel-based and web-based tools that are developed with the expectation of the client as a financial planning tool long after. Obviously, I have to find out what long means.
And whether there's a SaaS charge for it as well, which might be okay. But is any of that addressed specifically in the proposal?
No,
I didn't see it.
No.
Right. So to me, that is my concern is that if the 99,000, again, it's the loss leader type thing, if the 99,000 is just for the work that they're going to do to respond to the RFP, but in order to get the model, now you need to spend another 15 to 20K every year or even now, I want to know that.
This is something that we want to forward the negotiation post tonight. That's where it has to be. It has to be a link. Boilerplate on a web page here is nice, but it's for.
Thank you.
Okay. So. Have the agenda item. Board members have all of it.
I don't have a question, but I'm comfortable with going with Rectella's side of the difference. Not knowing the answer to Bob's question, if we could, I don't know, is it possible to put some language on the motion? Already got a financial recommended budget of $1,000. If we're saying like we have to go back and negotiate the terms of the rate paid with Rectella's, including access to the model for not to exceed amount of $100,000, I'm comfortable. So, and I would say I think that's a value in spite of the fact that it's more, because if we're getting four community meetings. $1,000 more. I mean, just standing up a community by itself once is it have to put on in order to get those. So I think that there's
comments on. You were part of the committee also.
Look at how we do engineering projects. Project at the board level, move staff to go and negotiate. to approve this. Is there a linkage into Springbrook? Yeah.
Springbrook. That's our council.
Is there an import export? I mean, Excel with. Negotiating SaaS contracts is very different than watch out for.
Given the comparative nature of contracts and what Director Mayhood has including the experience that Reptelis has in the local area and what they've been doing in Santa Cruz. But before we go, we do need to hear from the public. So, members of the public that are participating remotely, I see that Mark Dolson's. So, Mark.
Yeah, thank you. I'm sorry. I know you guys are trying. I know now that I should be there in person, but I do want to give you some feedback in case you're able to adapt your behavior at all in real time. The audio is getting worse and worse, and it correlates strongly with people leaning back in their seats or lowering their voice. Anybody that forgets to essentially shout into the microphone is inaudible. And that means I haven't been able to hear most of what Rick has said, what Jeff has said, what Gail has said, and now even what Bob is saying, and some of what you said, Mark. Just letting you know.
Okay. Thank you. Fortunate. Okay. Other members of the public attending remotely, Jim Mosier.
Yeah. I've been trying to follow and I've had the same trouble that Mark's had. I am on the Budget and Finance Committee, and I thought I would just, I unfortunately did not understand. I just couldn't follow what the conversation was and what the concerns were that Bob raised. It just didn't come true. But I just wanted to say that one of the things that made me very positive about Reptelis is the public outreach aspect of this. I took a pretty careful look at how Santa Cruz Water District handled their relationship to the public. To get the public involved, to get them to understand, to break down the rates. They did a very good job. I don't know what the contractor's role in with that was, But I was less than impressed with the other proposal, in part because I felt that how they handled the outreach to the public last time, and it could have just been a board problem, but I felt like we have one contractor who really did participate, at least behind the scenes, in a very positive way in terms of outreach to the public. And I think that is just going to be critical as we go forward. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jim. Alina Lang.
I think everyone kind of beat me to it that we can't hear anything. I could hear Bob a lot better. And as far as Jamie saying the closed caption, like there was like no audio pickup, like there's just complete blanks. But for some reason, Bob, I can pick up better. So, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. To members of the public that are in attendance here, we have two. Please address it at the microphone.
My name is Rick Moran from Ben Lomond. I'd just like to make sure that this company meets the criteria for the possibility of tiered rates. I know that was something that was left out in the last one, and
I'll just say that was specified in our proposal, that was one thing that
and Santa Cruz. With no other public comment at this point, we do have a motion on the table. I am hearing amendments to that.
Would you like me to restate it as accepting the things that Jamie said as a friendly amendment?
Certainly.
You did. I move that the board direct the district manager to enter into negotiations with in order to conduct the 2020 study. An amount not to exceed $99,000, contingent on acceptable clarification that the access to the modeling tool goes through the entire rate study and available in format afterwards.
I just want to be sure.
Well, I'm going to leave that to you. I mean, obviously, it's not forever, right? It might be that there will be some cost, but it's that's for you and Kendra. Either if you have some questions about it, I think. Serve us for the next 30 years.
We could say to for model for a period until the district takes that it completes 5 years, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's how long.
That's kind of my thoughts. Okay.
That would be fine.
Look at that one then. Santa Lorenzo Valley Water District's representation on the Santa Margarita groundwater agency. Since I am one of the board members that requested this, I will start. This motion or this memo was precipitated by an article that Director Foltz published in the San Lorenzo Valley Post. And specifically, he was calling out two other agencies that are partners with us in the Santa Margarita Agency. Comments that he made, I feel, make it difficult for the district to work cooperatively with our partner agencies there. It created an antagonistic environment within the agency, and as such, I don't feel that he can effectively the board members in the Santa Margarita Agency. So that's why I requested that we discuss that this evening. Director Mayhood also requested this, and she is currently on the Santa Margarita board. Most recent meeting had along with Director Foltz, and I'd like her to comment on this further.
Well, I asked for this item to be agendized with considerable reluctance. I met with Bob before his first Santa Margarita meeting and let him know how I was looking forward to him because he engaged with the technical aspects of the topic for the board, that he brings financial acumen to the board. District. We had a great discussion, and so I was blindsided when I read the article that Bob published days later in the Santa Margarita Post, in which he expressed views about proposed Santa Margarita projects and needless about Scotts Valley and Santa Cruz Water District. Privately, article and explain the reasons why. Bob made it clear to me that he does not intend to stop writing articles expressing private views on I've agreed to disagree on the appropriateness of directors expressing private views outside the confines of board meetings. That's a topic that it would be ill-advised for our board to address. However, I do think it's the responsibility of the board to consider whether we want a board member representing the district to express his views outside of board settings in ways that are antagonistic to our decided that I do not, and unfortunately, this trumps whatever other beneficial attributes Bob brings as a representative. Thinking about this, to understand how unusual the powers are that the representative, unlike members of San Lorenzo Valley Water District committees, where any decision the committee has to go to the board as a recommendation and then is acted by the board, our Santa Margarita representatives vote on issues without ever communicating their. Also, the Santa Margarita bylaws, for better or worse, provide a veto power on important issues in which any individual board member from the three founding agencies can veto those actions, including adopting significant reports, approving grant proposals, and finalizing the budget, including what is effectively a line item veto of expenditures. Potentially gives a single representative from our district enormous power. Given these unusual powers, I think it's important that the board has to have confidence that their representatives will act responsibly and prudently in representing the district. The third is that given Bob's strongly held beliefs, he used this veto power to make what he considers principled public statements.
Mark, that Bob's behavior puts unnecessarily complicates the lives of our staff who have to work in Santa Cruz and the county, on Santa Margarita, and many other issues. It also undermines my ability as our district. I've worked very hard in 2 years I've been on the board, and even 2 years before that, when I went to public member, pushed back when I felt like other consultants or members of other agencies were agendas that were detrimental. I restricted my remarks to those Santa Margarita board meetings or to I did try to find common ground where I came late with a change of leadership at Scotts Valley. It has emerged that there's really an alignment of interests between our district and any issues. I share an optimism that we rally within the construct. And for that reason, that I found Bob's reckless and antagonistic and frankly factual comments concerning veterans of Valley Coast, that Bob's conduct makes him ill-suited to represent our district, and I reluctantly conclude place him with another board member.
Well, we'd like to hear from you.
Well, there's a lot to unpack there. I've already been beside
him. I didn't attempt to live that Gale.
I hear you. But, you know, there's so many things here to unpack. There seems to be a sense, and I think the board members have expressed this, the only place a board member can communicate the lead inside a board meeting. That is fundamentally anti-democratic, un-American, and contrary to our system of government. We are obligated to communicate with our constituents on matters of supreme importance. That isn't just in board meetings, because what do we have? Five people, seven people from the community, and there'll be a handful of people that will look at. This notion of a board attempting some way to find the free of its board members extremely disturbing. I think anybody in the community looking at this would have to ask themselves, what was said that was so over the top? Comments that were nothing more than I had expressed in previous articles during the campaign recently, at board meetings, and in conversations with the community, caused people to go, oh my God. Not a single person approached me. Not a single person. What we have here are folks, I mean, we say that there is antagonism. With whom? Who are these people? Are they in the shadows? Or are they willing to come out and actually debate? Yes, in public. Something that is of vital importance to the community around financial and environmental risk associated with ASRs and injection wells. Find that kind of behavior, that reluctance, to be counterproductive to the best interests of our community, best interests of the Santa Groundwater Agency community, is not good. So as everybody knows, I'm a free speech advocate, maximum transparency and total transparency. And everything that's been said so far runs counter to that. Also another aspect here that I just don't understand. The city of Santa Cruz does sit on the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency, correct? according to the lecture that I got on, we're all supposed to work together as a team. We actually have differing opinions. One of the opinions that Santa Cruz brought to the table was their objection to our ISM&D, which would have accelerated the ability of our district to start using the surface water resources that we have in a better fashion to be able to address the groundwater issue. How does that teamwork? Why is that representative remaining on the board? To me, that was one of the most unbelievable things that could have happened. I'm not going to sit down as members of that agency and negotiate that. But my article is so over the top that it exceeds that. Was a significant policy decision that they made. I've made no secret of the fact, even before this board voted to appoint me, I oppose and will never vote for anything that has to do with an ASR that comes out of our community pocket or in any way disturbs our quiet enjoyment of our aquifer resources. Puts any of that at risk in the short term. I've said this publicly before. Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency should be putting all of its emphasis behind maximum utilization of surface water during those months that it is available, order to rest as many wells in our area as possible. We should do that for a period of time, see what that impact is. Aside any of the stuff to do with the ASRs until later. Those are last resort items, and the fact that there's still an enormous amount of emphasis being placed on that need also deviates from the concept of teamwork. We're going to operate as a team. How about if we work together in those things that we all agree upon, not try to force people into accepting through one way or another things that we don't agree upon. So I find that very interesting. And I don't think anybody has talked about that in the past, but we were blocked from being able to move forward because of the action taken by one of our team members on the Santa Margarita groundwater. I've also made it very clear that if they wish to pursue those on their own nickel, that's great. They may have more of an interest in doing that than we do. This is not something that our community needs. I think take a look at the recordings. Last two board meetings, I have done what I normally do. I ask questions, finally, at a policy level. Unlike others at the last meeting, I did not disparage any group or any small group. I set myself up as some arbiter between two groups that I am uniquely capable of understanding. Don't do that in the board meetings. And at the end of the day, what we're trying to achieve here, nothing more than groupthink, no participating. You guys knew that before you voted for me in the first time. I am incredibly at no one had the courage to come talk to me. Apparent courage to come talk to me. I'm happy to talk to other than Gail. Happy to talk to anybody. Listed in the book. I have my email published. So I'm really actually not convinced it was
that much of an issue as it's been about to be here. Because I have no firsthand knowledge of it. It's pure hearsay. And even if somebody didn't like what I wrote, okay, you know something? There's a lot of things that other people do that I don't like either, but I don't try to shut them down or say, well, you can't do this or you can't do that. I believe in free speech. I believe in the fact that if we understand where people are coming from, then we'll be able to get to a better resolution. Out the fear having to police what it is that they say. And if we can't do that as a community, then we have bigger issues. If my article is so bad that everybody goes, oh my God, and we're going to clutch pearls, we have a bigger problem in this community than my article. I will continue to communicate with our community on issues of vital importance. And I'm not the only one. I'm not going to stop that. Board doesn't like that? Well, I mean, you guys do. It is, you know, you can make it a 4-1 vote. That's my responsibility for you. It may not be something that everybody shares, but I get a lot of people thanking me for the fact that I'm willing to stand up and talk about these things, not just in the board meeting. That is what I think people are.
The other two directors?
I'm obviously eager to hear from the public on this, but I'm a no. I'll just put it out there. I'm going to be a no on this. I think it goes to a larger principle. First of all, I write. And I like to express my opinion. And I think the idea that we can foreclose upon a board member for doing so, even when we disagree with or don't like their opinion, the real problem for me, because we did know that Bob likes to express himself in writing when we put him on. And we did know that he can be acerbic, that he does that. And we did know, at least in my view, there's nothing that I read in his article that was surprise to me. Right? So I can disagree with the way that he characterized the city of Santa Cruz. That's my right to do so as a member of the public and a member of the board. The idea that we will remove him so quickly if he's done the thing that we don't like, he's expressed an opinion that we don't like in a manner in which we don't like it to be done. To be honest, in the national environment that we are operating in politically, I find this to be a little fascistic. So I am going to be a no on this.
Well, first of all, say that the real issue I have with it on matter of kindness or would have been nice if we had no I'm not saying ask for permission. I'm just saying it would have
absolute right to do.
Than that, I'd also like to hear from the public. We have two members here.
My name is from Ben Wolf. 2 years ago, I served. 2 years ago, I served on the same line. I strongly disagree with the motion to remove Director Foltz in a margarita groundwater. Director Foltz has written an article in a local paper to inform the public about water issues in our area. If there is any disagreement about that article, people should make their own argument about the issues. That is how our government is supposed to operate, free and open debate about the issues. Remove Bob would have a chilling effect on all the citizens who may have legitimate differences. Trying to remove people is not the way to win a debate. Director Foltz has been twice elected and is the longest serving member on this board.
Chris Moran, and I've read the letter in the FLB post written by Bob Foltz regarding the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency, along with their code of conduct, as well as the code of conduct of the FLB Water District. And I don't see that the article is demeaning, rude, but I found it important. For this agenda item, is in connection with concerns that publications like the Post article are inconsistent with FLBWC's effective participation and leadership on the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency Board and want to remove Director Foltz and fill the vacancy by making another appointment. Where protected speech is involved, he goes on to say, where protected speech is involved, any venture or other punitive action against the director would be appropriate. And you're right, it would be inappropriate. Director Foltz has written regularly and continues on various matters in other local newspapers, informing his constituents about what's going on from his point of view. His letters conclude that they are his own and they don't represent the board, as the same article included that you're all concerned about right now. I read letters from McPherson, Panetta, Eshu, and John Lair. Both is being singled out, and I gotta tell you, this is still undemocratic to me. Voted for Bob Bolt twice, and to represent us, and he is, and thank you, Bob. And when Mr. Foltz is fulfilling that, instead of supporting him, you're bending to the will of another organization. Folks watching out for our rights. Business own guiding principles state, quote, discussions between them and other users and members may be challenging at times, and here we are, but they should be in a collaborative manner with commitment respectful to civil discourse between all participants. Where is that civil discourse? This is ending discourse. Constituents deserve knowledge, and that's what we're getting. They're keeping it all inside the closed door. That's how ironic that the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency, having a veiled admonishment of Mr. Colton's informative piece, that Valley City of Santa Cruz and FLB Water are mandated to get along, and then have their own board member reference horrible Scott Valley builders and those, sorry, Mountain Monkeys. That in itself is pretty demeaning. We're supposed to remove Bob Holt for having an opinion and an opinion. This doesn't look good. And what you do here tonight will ripple through the valley. Bob Holt has been voted on his board twice by voters in the San Lorenzo Valley. He's left it. I suggest that you discuss this and fall back to a position of civil discord with a respected member of this board, Bob Holt. Take no action. Find another way.
Would any member of the public who's participating remotely like to comment? Jim Moser?
Yes, I feel that I'm at a disadvantage because I haven't been able to follow the conversations. But I just want to say that I don't see this at least as an issue of free speech. It's a matter of strategy, whether Bob is the right person to be representing us in Santa Margarita when we're in these very delicate negotiations. And we need to build alliances in order to be able to get what's best for the valley. I ran into this kind of problem when I worked to get the Felton Library, where we had similar kinds of demeaning comments about those of us in the valley, but we needed to get an alliance with the county in order to be able to get that library. We had Scotts Valley and the city of Santa Cruz fighting against us, and we had to be very strategic. And I have not been attending the Santa Margarita meetings, but I know Bob can be very, very forceful with his opinions. It may not be the right assignment for him. And that's the issue here. It isn't, to me, a matter of free speech. It's a matter of strategy and tactics. So I urge the board to be thinking about who will represent us best in these delicate negotiations right now. Thank you.
Would anybody else from the public like to comment, attending remotely? Seeing none, then I will make the motion. Go ahead,
one more thing. Thank you. I respect you guys on all sorts of levels. I don't disagree with you.
Given that we don't have a move ahead with this, I don't think we need to at this point.
I would like to make a claim that I don't think I want to. That is that this has nothing to do. Raising the issue and essentially accusing me of being. I thought Mark was the one who brought. So I would just emphasize that I have no objections to Bob. He wants to write articles. And in fact, the article that he wrote, probably the first two-thirds of it, I would have absolutely signed on to. The mechanistic comment, that's the part. It's not educating our public, which I think he likes to do, and it's a good thing that he does. All I'm saying is that I know that that people did. However, the comments that were made by one of the people in direct response, however inartful they were made, to what he thought was Bob fomenting discord having to do with stereotypes. But I think we just need to find out, and whether it's the Santa Margarita saying things that are clumsy jokes, or whether it's Bob, the contributing motives to West Valley or Santa Cruz? Try to work together. All problems that we're trying to. To better and to spread carefully. After they hold it. What I was referring to as fascistic would censure someone by as a response to my view, not liking what they said. I understand that you see it. That's the lens through which I see. I'm not going to be persuaded by this conversation. It's not, you know, a construction. Because, as I said earlier, there's nothing that surprises me in Bob's actions based on who he was before we appointed him. So, that being said, you know, I think that I agree we should all try to be civil. But being civil within the boundaries of talking about things that you need to talk about, difficult conversations need to be had. Now, I can disagree all day with the way that Bob characterized the city of San Francisco, and that was an artful. But I can't say that I want to take it in my disagreement with the way that level of removing him.
Moving on then, consent agenda, anybody wish to pull anything from that? District reports, the district manager's report?
I don't really like to say I apologize for the audiovisual tonight. We are working on it. A lot of bugs. Hearings order. Hopefully, we have our next meeting. Apologize to the general public and to the board.
For that, in this meeting.